let's have a look at some of the issues to consider with a solar PV system and when things go wrong. So let's start by looking at how one of these systems is put together in a simple schematic. So what we got is a bunch of solar panels. Now that's the symbol for a solar panel. Solar panels on systems typically are connected in series with plugs and sockets like this. And so we'll have what's known as a string of solar panels. So the positive of one connects to the negative of the next, and that builds up the voltage across the array. So the voltage is going up as we add more solar panels to the string. Now, in systems, as they get bigger, you often have more than one string. You also have what's called a home run cable. Now, that cable will be one that goes from the last module in the string all the way back to a disconnection point. Now, depending on the age of the system, that disconnection point may well be a roof-mounted DC isolator, typically called a rooftop isolator. Great naming, eh? And it's required to be load breaking. That means it can be switched off while it's operating. It's a load break switch disconnector technically, and it should be labeled such as a DC isolator. But in newer systems, since the new standard for PV arrays, ASNZS 5033, the 2021 edition, we introduced a new feature, which was something called the disconnection point. Now, the disconnection point allows you to not have a load break disconnector, but just use the plug and sockets that are at the end of the string as the point of disconnection. Now, let me draw the two types. So we've got a load break disconnector, and that's the symbol for a load break disconnector. Oops, hang on. Load break disconnector, and it'll be ganged, so both poles disconnect at the same time, so the positive and negative. Or we may well have simply another plug and socket like this. And this type is known as a disconnection point, or DP for short. Now the DP disconnection point is required to be labeled on the site plan, so the solar site plan. Now this is only going to be in newer systems, really probably since this year, 2022, where people adopting it, and therefore that disconnection point requires a label at the solar site plan, which should be in a location that can be seen easily. That may well be the main switchboard or near the inverter, and it should identify those points. Now, a key difference between the load break isolator, so-called rooftop isolator, and the disconnection point is that one of these can be operated under load. That's the load break, obviously. It also can be done by anyone. It's not actually electrical work to turn it on and off, though it is recommended that you turn off the AC first at the inverter. Why do you do that? Well, turning off the AC at the inverter means that there's no load. The PV array is not producing any current, and so when you switch that switch, it's under basically 0 amps, and therefore it's unlikely to fail. There is a risk factor with any DC isolator that switching it off under load is going to cause a small amount of contact arcing. They're designed for it, but you don't want to really push that friendship, so therefore turning off the AC first. However, in contrast, with the disconnection point, it is actually electrical work because it's a plug and socket that requires a tool to disconnect. It must be disconnected with no load, because actually disconnecting DC under load will generate a very large arc at relatively modest voltage levels. We're talking like, you know, a 10 centimeter arc at 400 volts DC. I mean, that's a big arc. It's because DC doesn't cross through 0 volts 100 times every second. It's actually continuous current. And when you try to interrupt it, it tries to maintain that connection. It actually forms a plasma as it arcs and melts the conductors. So unplugging one of those disconnection points under load is very risky. So it's required to be labeled. The disconnection point must have a label stating that it do not operate under load. So there'll be a little label on either side of it. It'll be a yellow label, and it'll have the words do not disconnect under load. And that's going to be a first warning, really, that this could be potentially hazardous if you try to disconnect it without first turning off the inverter. So let's have a look at that. So there's a warning label, and it'll be yellow with black writing either side of those cables, one or both sides, indicating that you should turn off the load, and you should know what you're doing. So basically, this is usually licensed electrical work in every state and territory in Australia, and use the appropriate tool to disconnect that. Now, why would you want to operate that disconnection point? Really, if the system has been damaged and you want to ensure that there are no live cables coming from the roof down inside the building, that's one reason that you would operate this disconnection point. Or if you have multiple strings and you want to isolate one string that's in parallel with another string. Now, what I've drawn here is actually a non-parallel system, but it's possible to have more than one string connected. So let's just open up a new window here. And let's draw a string of panels. So this is my string of panels, and they're all connected in series together. So I'll have an output that's positive, and I'll have another output that's negative, and I might have another parallel string. Now, if the person who installed this system was doing their job properly, they'll know that paralleling strings, there must be the same number of panels at each string of the same type. So we've got two strings identical, and we've got another positive cable here, and we've got another return negative cable here. Now, these can be paralleled. When there's only two strings, you can actually parallel them just like this. And there we go. We've paralleled them. So we now have a negative and a positive, what's called array cable, leading from the PV array back down to the inverter, or if it's an off-grid system or a DC coupled system, it might be a charge controller. But it's important that if there is a damage to any one of those strings and you want to isolate it, that you have a means to do that. And that's why we require a disconnection point. So that disconnection point is actually the plug and sockets here. So we can see the label stating that these are disconnection points, and we'll turn off the load, which is the inverter, and or charge controller if it's DC coupled. And then we'll check that there is no current flowing. How do you check? Well, you actually need a special piece of equipment called a DC current tool, or current measuring tool. You might be familiar with AC so-called tong testers that you can just put across a cable and measure the current. They don't work with DC, because DC doesn't have an alternating current that induces a current into the secondary of your test equipment. You have to use something that uses a transducer. It's a Hall effect transducer. So it's a more expensive piece of kit. Many of the brand named meters have these as an option for their higher level products. So if you've got a current clamp that you can clamp around a cable, make sure it's got a DC range on it. And if it doesn't, you will need one. So putting it onto the DC range allows you to test first before disconnecting. Even though you think you've disconnected, you may well have turned off the inverter, but actually under some circumstances where you've got dissimilar voltages on each string, and that can be because of a short circuit or other faults within the system. So say we actually have a fault in this system whereby some current is bypassing some of the modules. It's going through all of them but two. You've actually got a different voltage in string number two. So this is string number two down here, and this is string number one up here. The voltage of string number one will be higher than string number two, and therefore will actually start to create circulating currents within the array. Even if you've turned off the isolator that goes, or the disconnection point that goes back to the inverter, you'll find that some of the current will be flowing from one string to the other. So you'll be getting this flow of current that may well look like this. The higher string will flow into the lower string like this. And so that current is going to flow around and around, basically following that path. There we go. And therefore, we've got circulating currents within the array that we cannot turn off. And you wouldn't know that unless you test it. So what do you do? you've actually found a faulty system that has circulating currents within the array between two parallel strings. Even though you've turned off the inverter, the current's still flowing, therefore you can't disconnect the plug and socket safely. You have two choices, possibly three. Choice number one, wait for nightfall. No sun, no current. Beware if you've got very powerful spotlights, they can actually generate some current, but really not much. Option number two is cover the panels completely with a very dark tarpaulin. And once again, check to see if there's any current flowing, so you simulate at night. And thirdly, there is actually some products which you can spray onto the panels. It's kind of like a black film that shuts them down because no light, no current. So there are your three options. The easiest one, of course, is just to wait for nightfall. But don't risk it. Don't try disconnecting those plug and sockets while current is flowing, because it can just burn the ends off the plugs and leave you holding some naked live wires. So there you go. Anyway, that's the basis of understanding how to de-energize a PV system down to a string level. You can take that one step further. Once you've disconnected the string and no current's flowing, you can actually disconnect every module in that string, because there is no short circuit paths within the array. Once again, if in doubt, use your DC current clamp to test the cable before you do any plugs and socket disconnections.